I would like to say welcome to the Center for Responsible Business Rudolf Peterson Speaker Series. I'm Robert Strand and have the privilege to call myself the Executive Director of the Center for Responsible Business here at Berkeley-Haas. And the title of today's session is Corporate Sustainability and Materiality, Strategy, Practice, and Implementation. And with that, Dan, I'd like to turn the floor over to you.
Thank you, Robert, and thanks everybody for being here today, and especially thanks to our panelists. Let me just give an introduction. On my left, Divya Mankikar, who's head of ESG integration with CalPERS, and those who don't follow and know it, CalPERS, hundreds of billions, let me leave it at that, major impact to do anything with that kind of scale. So we're thrilled to have Divya here who can provide to this discussion of sustainability from the perspective of an asset owner, a fiduciary who's investing on the behalf of beneficiaries who have a time horizon of decades, both as an asset owner and fiduciary, but also as someone who hires external investment managers to implement those. And to her left, George Serafeim from Harvard, who's published a number of really noteworthy studies that take the concept of sustainability from a concept to nuts and bolts and real numbers behind it. And so thrilled to have George to bring some real substance to the conversation. And then finally, Susanne Stormer, who makes this all real by reflecting the corporate perspective, because none of this matters unless we have corporations that are innovating, creating jobs, creating economic activity that makes the world go round. There's no stocks to buy and sell without corporates. So feel really privileged to have these three experts and really accomplished from different perspectives on the field. And with that, again, Robert highlighted within the Haas community, a lot of the hands here were students, a subset of which in the HSRIF, but importantly, also more broadly, interest from across the campus, and equally importantly, a multidisciplinary. So we've got business school people in the audience, we've got folks from other disciplines, and we've got folks from other venues. And so that's part of what's exciting, I think, to all of us who are involved in sustainability, is that to do it right, it's like they say 12 blind men describing an elephant or whatnot. There's many different aspects to getting it right. And so that's an opportunity for students cutting their teeth and thinking about a career path. And maybe just to open it up, let me go to George and ask just to sort of frame and start a discussion about how to make corporate sustainability strategic and material. To open the discussion, George, any thoughts on what this whole area means for career value value creation? What's it means for students who are looking at this world today?
Dan, this is a great question, because actually looking at this room, it's amazing, actually. When I started working in this area, you could get hardly 10 people in a room like this. And now we have 150 people. I started a class with a colleague at Harvard Business School. We could hardly get 20 students to take the course. Now there are more than 350 people, MBA students at Harvard, that want to take the course. Just yesterday, I was at the Schwab Impact event for all registered investment advisors, mainstream capital markets. They didn't have even an event around sustainability and ESG. And this year I was presenting and I had about 200 registered investment advisors that had no idea about what we're talking about, but they wanted to learn about it. So I think there is tremendous growth that we have experienced in terms of having a discussion and being interested in this space, which means that there are lots of exciting opportunities for value creation for students actually in this space. I think there are opportunities for value creation on the corporate space, because those issues, climate change, innovation, diversity, and so forth, are becoming very, very important issues for companies. They're becoming very, very important issues for investment organizations, and they are building up their capabilities and their teams. And I think fundamentally there is also tremendous opportunities for entrepreneurial activity. So if you want, actually, you can enter, for example, the investment space, and you can build new venture capital firms, new private equity firms, and so forth, that actually take those concepts of sustainability and they disrupt the market. It's the same thing for organizations in the corporate space. Think, for example, about insurance companies and how do you deliver insurance services to a wider access of clients, right? It's the same thing about transportation. Same thing. You find a tremendous wave of innovation and disruption that's happening. And that creates tremendous opportunities, I think, for young people in this space across the value chain. So I think it's very exciting.
So over to Susanne, if I were to put a stock chart of Novo Nordisk, it would be what we call in the business up and to the right. A tremendous, tremendous compounded return to shareholders reflecting underlying value growth. Not a leap of faith about some future growth, but just tremendous, tremendous track record. Perhaps you can comment to what extent you think sustainability is a part of that, and we can get some conversation on what that means.
Yeah, I'd love to. So I actually made a small experiment because we have a CEO who's been in office since 2000, and it's just been announced that he's stepping down by the end of this year. And his position will be taken over by another internal candidate who is also a long tenure. So in the company that I work with, we certainly are there for the long term. So my experiment was this. Let's look at the share price development and see how it factors in with some of the events that we've seen and also how it correlates to our efforts to engage with stakeholders, to understand stakeholders' perspectives, and really to, if you will, read our market in a broader sense than the conventional indicators. And the point is that our CEO is rightly recognized for driving that trend. And then, of course, I'm just privately saying now in the audience of 150 students, well, I joined at about the same time. So, but the point is here, and I think it's interesting to also discuss with my fellow panelists is, this is a question, is there a correlation or is there a causality? And yesterday I was invited to join a conversation that was precisely about that. How do you evaluate, for instance, good human rights management in a company? And what I've been told repeatedly is don't even go there. Don't even try to make that point because it's futile. So what we've done instead is actually to say, well, we don't care whether you can make that conclusive argument or not. I mean, if George does, and he's very close to it, I'm sure he would be a candidate for the Nobel Award. But I think that what we've been able to do is actually to point to some factors that we can present, and then it will be up to you whether it's as an analyst, as an academic, or as an investor, whether or not you believe it. So part of what we've been doing is to build a series of business cases, if you will, where we try to evaluate the impact that we have on customers, in societies, and also how it correlates with the business impact. And we don't make the stretch, but we just present the facts. And they seem to be quite convincing. And then just finally, maybe to say that I recently read a study that points out that good stakeholder engagement actually correlates with a 2% increase in your share price per year. So if you take that over a 10-year or a 20-year period, then you could then divide it or multiply it by two. So it's 20% over a 10-year period. So at least I would say that some part and measure of the financial success of the company, I would ascribe to what my team and I have been able to do. You can prove me wrong.
Thank you. And Divya, perhaps you can provide some thoughts from your perspective, leading the charge on ESG integration and making sustainability real in the investment scene, in particular for our students here today. Could you share some thoughts with what you see as the landscape for really education? Part of this is multidisciplinary. I don't think there's a handbook on the shelf you can pull off that'll provide a roadmap to the opportunity here.
Yeah, sure. So CalPERS, as Dan mentioned, manages $300 billion, and it's on behalf of 1.8 million public sector employees in California. So if we shut our doors today, our liabilities would actually extend 70 to 100 years, depending on, you know, the lifespan of our beneficiaries. And so a few years ago, really post-financial crisis, we thought more deeply about our assumptions around risk and how we need to broaden those assumptions. So one of the things we did was create a new set of investment beliefs. And two of them in particular, I think, are most relevant for this discussion. One is that value creation beyond the traditional metrics requires effective management of three forms of capital, which is natural capital, human capital, and financial capital. And that's really sort of the ESG, you know, investment belief. And the other one is that risk is not fully expressed in traditional metrics like volatility, which if you've ever worked with pension funds, they're very concerned about tracking error. And so this is another attempt to go beyond those typical risks and look into ESG research, look into quote-unquote non-financial factors that companies are reporting to get a broader sense of risk. And so unfortunately, we have these investment beliefs in this framework, but when you come to implementation, which is really my role, to support each of the asset classes and thinking about how to integrate ESG into investment decisions, there isn't a book that I can pull off the shelf to say, this is exactly how you do it. And the other structural difficulty I think that we have in finance in particular is that a lot of the way that we're taught finance is to look at a 30-year data set, get a trend line, you know, and extrapolate certain things under different market conditions. Whereas a lot of the ESG risks we're looking at, climate change, for example, requires looking ahead. So you can't always, you know, make an investment decision based on backwards-looking data. And so because of these, you know, shifts in a more expansive idea of what constitutes risk, as well as the need to look more into the future, it becomes a very interdisciplinary field. And so on the train ride down, I was actually thinking about, I did my own MBA at IE Business School in Spain. So I was thinking about, okay, what were some of the major courses we went through the MBA, accounting, finance, marketing, operations? All of those actually you could point to a skills gap in integrating ESG that we need, you know, motivated students to help the finance and corporate communities kind of bridge that gap. So if you're looking at accounting, for example, the integrated report that Novo Nordisk puts out is very helpful for investors. It's how we want to see corporate reporting on ESG, which is in the traditional financial statements. And so not, you know, going into all of these different sources of information. We want it basically to be deduced into a set of metrics that's specific to the industry and comparable and reported in financial statements. And that right now requires people with an accounting mindset and knowledge of, you know, accounting measures to say these are the factors that we're looking at. I know that SASB has done a lot of work to help bridge this gap as well, but it's not something that you're going to just pull up easily. It still requires a sort of leap of those analysts who are going to go out and do a little bit of extra research, because right now that data is not so easily available. If you go to finance and constructing different types of financial products, whether it's quantitative strategies or how you're devising your fundamental analysis, or if you're looking at optimizing an index based on an ESG factor, all of these things require going a bit beyond, you know, exactly what you're typically taught. So you can go through every, I think, sort of business school discipline and make these examples where institutional investors like CalPERS have this intent to integrate ESG further and further into investment decision making. And now we're at the stage of, you know, making those links and looking for those people who understand climate risk, diversity, different types of human rights, ESG risks, but then can also speak the language of finance.
Thank you. And we've got a few other questions. We'll keep the panel running. But if people do have questions, please, we'll certainly welcome that. Want to make this a conversation. And when we get to that, please use the microphones. But let me go to George next this idea. It's a classic kind of old school business management concept of where do you find value in an organization? That concept has been around and studied long before the acronyms of SRI, ESG, et cetera, became in practice. Maybe just use that as a launch pad to talk about how to think about the lens of ESG and sustainability.
So there is a core set of management principles if you're trying to create high-performance organizations. One of them is that that says that actually good management is a management that can actually concentrate on a very few areas in the organization and do that very, very well. So that applies actually to ESG quite a bit, because ESG is such a broad thing. So, and the idea is that if Novo Nordisk is trying to do everything, it will probably end up doing nothing well. So this is an idea that actually you need to concentrate your efforts. You need to align management systems, for example, incentives, performance metrics, employee engagement, and so forth. Innovate, invest in few focus areas that really matter for the business. And that is actually the idea of the financial materiality behind ESG issues, that you might have a menu of options. For example, SASB identifies 48 of them or something like that. But then the idea is like, what do I do with that? What do I concentrate on? And now what we have evidence about is that actually the firms that can concentrate manage a few specific issues that tend to be financially material for that industry that they're in and perform well on those issues are they actually the companies that tend to outperform in the future. So you take old management principles, you apply them to new business ideas, and you get the fundamental truth that actually you need to be well-run organizations are focused organizations, and those organizations too tend to perform well. And I want to mention one thing that links back to something that Susanne said that I consider extremely important, which is the idea of actually how difficult it is to change mindsets of people and to actually penetrate this idea that, you know, this works, this there is some kind of like causality and so forth. When I started working in this area, there were very few people that were working in this, and it was a much smaller space. As I said, we would need probably a coffee table at the cafeteria, not this room. And I remember that everybody, like most of the people, were like so negative about this space. So right away they would say, oh, Novo Nordisk would go bankrupt because they're doing this. Well, you know, they didn't. I heard people saying those things can never be measured. Well, they can. We can never have standards about those things. Well, we have emerging standards. CalPERS would never be interested in this. Well, you know, CalPERS is interested in this. Stock exchange would never be interested. Well, they have actually, right? So there is an idea here that actually lots of people are resistant to change. And even I remember in executive education programs when I started talking about those things 10 years ago, most of the executives, not all of them, but most of the executives were like, this will never make money. You can never drive change that way. And it ended up being wrong, actually. And because we're in a student audience, one thing that I want to say is that many people actually will say that this will never work. It will be extremely negative and so forth. And that is actually the idea of disruption in the market. Actually, disruption happens because most of the people believe that there is no disruption. And that's why suddenly everybody's surprised, and then you have, you know, Google and Uber and so forth, because actually fundamentally most of the people say this is not coming. And I think there is actually quite a bit of there are quite a few parallels here about what we're discussing, because the same thing you could listen, and I'm sure you listen to that as well, that actually mainstream investors would never care about those things and they would never build capabilities. They are building capabilities. There is a long way to go, but this is happening, right? And I think that's very important as we're looking at like the next 20 years and at careers for the next 20 and 30 years. You need to actually be able to disrupt, and you need to be able to say, no, actually I have a conviction and I believe in this. It makes sense. And then go forward.
Yeah, I had a couple of thoughts. One is that the concept is disruptive. We've had a real sea change in attitudes in the past, even decade, in terms of the notion of sustainability and ESG viewed as an overlay or a fashion statement versus the notion that it can be intrinsic to value creation. And to tag off again of this notion that, you know, 50 years ago, when you look at the basics of business management, the concept on focus on what matters and do it well, that is a very, I think, useful thread to follow. Something that comes to mind is Jim Kilts, who did a phenomenal job turning around Gillette before Procter ultimately acquired the business. He had a slogan, do what matters, wrote a book about it, doing what matters. You're going to succeed, if nothing, if you try to boil the ocean, but be laser focused on points of value creation, on materiality, and that's what George's academic work shows, is the notion of ESG. If you improve the noise to signal ratio by focusing on what matters, value comes manifest, and you can see it in the stock chart of Novo Nordisk, and Susanne spoke about that. And I think at CalPERS is certainly being proactive in recognizing there's value creation, but not if you try to be everything to everyone, not if it's a fashion follower versus leading through fundamental insight and focused on the business. And to just add a comment to how does this matter to students and taking advantage of the opportunity, to George's point, there's a disruptive opportunity, but it's for those who I think have the lens of value add, not a leadership point of view, but based on substance, not just a belief statement, but belief followed up by substance. And so for I think the professionals in the work world today who bring a toolkit of substance can bring real information, can bring real value. To be an expert at sustainable supply chain management, you've got to first be an expert in supply chain management. To be an expert in investment analytics in sustainability, first you have to be an expert in investment analytics. And then you can, you know, get in the tent of having real credibility, influence, and ultimately being a highly sought resource and a guide. So those are some thoughts. And then I thought maybe we turn the conversation to whether it's in the corporate side and the investor asset owner side and the academic side. Like, who's doing it well? What are the common threads behind who you would admire as other actors on the stage that are doing a good job incorporating sustainability, making it real? And then the counterpoint, what are the challenges to doing it well? Because it's still, I think, a minority. It's a point of exceptionalism to really be doing it well. And so you could describe this in an abstract general sense or name names, but however, Susanne, maybe you can comment.
I'd be happy to. So, I mean, obviously, I know one example, but let's talk about some
is
others.
Is it Novo Nordisk?
So, one of the companies that I admire a lot is actually SAP, that have gone to great lengths to make the links between factors such as employee engagement. We heard that word mentioned a couple of times here, and really relating that to value and being able to say that 1 point change in employee engagement would then translate to so much value in terms of financial value. And I think that's an interesting exercise, and I fully agree with what Dan says, that you have to have discipline in what you do. So, of course, the flip side of what SAP is doing is actually that, you know, it can be dismissed. So whenever you stick your neck out and say, this is how we see things, then there would be as many people wanting to go after your throat and say, but that's not how it works. That's not the kind of metrics. So so let me just share one example from our experience, because we were we wanted to find a measure of how well we are doing in actually serving the patients that we are here to deliver medicines for. And this is quite a complicated area because, frankly, we don't know how many patients we serve. So in other businesses, you would know how many customers do you have. What we know is how much volume we sell in terms of the active medical or active pharmaceutical ingredient. So we were struggling to see if we could come up with some kind of metric. And we ended up saying, well, let's just have a proxy for how much volume is then consumed by one patient and then use that. And so we came up with a proxy that is based on WHO numbers. So we thought that was actually quite smart. We'd worked with corporate accounting, with all of the internal experts. And then we got to a point when we were about to release our annual report in which this number was for the first time. And then I'm in a meeting with my CFO and he says, what's that number? And I said, well, it's a number of patients that we serve. Where does that come from? And then I was explaining, you know, how we arrived at it. And I also said, it's an estimate. But we can't have estimates into our financial report. And of course, any analyst would know that there are a number of estimates in any financial report. So it's just to say that there are so many factors that you're up against. So I think the happy end to this story is I survived the conversation. We managed to keep that number in the report. The year after, we were actually able to then define a target for how many patients we wanted to reach over a 10-year period so that we can now use it as a guide. So is it a correct number? No, it's not. It can be killed. But I think it does serve as a valuable proxy. So I think just to share that illustration is you have to have combined teams that can think in smart ways about what are the new ways of measuring and analyzing that. And then you have to have the courage to just stand up for it.
So at the risk of it sounding like a total softball question, is there a culture that comes out of the C-suite at Novo Nordisk that says one of the markers of value for us is serving public health? And if that's so, then maybe there can be rally behind metrics like that as one of the proof statements, which is very different from a financial metric that, you know, if it's a pure financial metric model, then price increases alone will get you there. Price increases on declining volumes, which has been a fantastic financial algorithm for tobacco. You know, volumes are in decline, but people are addicted, so they, you know, put the prices up. Generic pharmaceuticals, you know, low value add pharmaceuticals, there's cases where because of barriers, they've been able to extract pricing, which is, can show up as a financial marker. But if those markers are not in context of, for example, again, a marker of public health or something, that could cause some dissonance. So,
yeah, I think you're right that you have to have a culture that appreciates these alternative ways of measuring and making the argument. We have a conversation internally that goes like this. Well, we don't do all of this responsible business stuff because we want to make profit. We do it because we think it's the right thing to do. But actually, I've been advocating that we have to be able to also make that profitability argument, because otherwise we won't be able to continue to come up with initiatives like the ones I quoted before. So I think you have to have both ends into the equation. So that's probably also where we need research like what George and his team are doing, because we need to present evidence that doesn't come from me or people in similar positions as me. It has to be by, you know, arbitrators that are seen as, independent. And also, what I really have valued is the many times I've been in conversations with analysts together with our C-suite members and our investor relations people, and actually having had intelligent conversations about what can be measured in new ways. And that is an eye-opener.
And I would applaud Novo Nordisk and your role in being an example for, you know, profits is not a dirty word. On the contrary, without a engine of profits, you don't have the funds to invest in innovation, which drive positive health outcomes. There is no, in my mind, as an investor, no dissonance between social justice and, you know, highly profitable value-creating enterprise at all. But I think leadership is really helpful to make that case, be my perspective. So Divya, from an asset owner perspective, an investor, you've got to generate returns to serve your beneficiaries. What's your perspective on who else does it well, and what are the challenges to that everybody's not doing it well? There's been a lot of discussion about short-termism, taking a long-term view really does drive value. And even though it's on the front page and there's plenty of studies to back it up, the reality still exists where it's a minority of asset owners that really take the long view.
Sure. So despite the size of CalPERS fund, on average in public equity, for example, we own 0.5% of a company. And there are over 10,000 companies in our benchmark. So in terms of identifying who does it well, we actually have, over the last 10 years, built a network and participated in investor networks to work together with a lot of other funds. So APG, PGGM, Norges, UAW Trust in Michigan, which is United Auto Workers, the New York City and New York State funds. There's a whole global coalition of institutional investors who are engaging companies, who are active in public policy discussions, and who are also piloting and sharing notes on, you know, ESG implementation strategies. So I think the good news is that a lot of the largest investors globally, Australia, New Zealand as well, are, you know, out there sort of sticking their necks out to say, this is important to us. A lot of these issues represent systemic risks. You know, we can't divest our way from this problem. We have real estate holdings that will, even if we, you know, don't own fossil fuel stocks, for example, in equity, sea level rise will still affect our real estate positions or our private equity portfolios. And so they're looking at it in partnership with us from a really holistic and total fund approach, which is the shift that has happened, I think, quite recently. And so the good news is that there are a lot of other funds whom we admire and whom we have to partner with in order to make the changes in public policy and in corporate disclosure that help us to further integrate ESG. And yet, so this was a great year in terms of integrating climate risk into investment decisions. We started less than 12 months ago with the agreement of the Paris Accord, where nearly 200 governments agreed to limit their emissions in line with the 2 degrees trajectory. And we had the Financial Stability Board, which is an international entity that advises the central banks, form a task force that's meant to inform the global financial community of what companies should be disclosing about climate risk. So two big international sort of initiatives that are helping us to integrate climate risk. And then also within sort of shareholder resolutions at a number of different companies in all of the regional markets, we had big wins where companies, you know, even in some cases, the management supported the concept that they should be disclosing to investors what climate risks are faced by their different business units. And so that's all making us quite optimistic. We feel like the wind is behind our sails. However, when you come to the US, unfortunately, we still have quite a disparity between a lot of these wins that we're seeing on a global stage and the same thing amongst fund managers in the US. So the same proposal with the same set of investors has gotten, you know, more than 96% of the vote behind it in Europe, whereas in the US, there's the quote-unquote missing 60%, where it's about 30 to 49% of share owners voting in favor of a proposal. So this is one of the things that we're looking out for in terms of the laggards, or where we're looking to see future partnership, is why this regional disparity and how fund managers can work with us to, you know, for all of us to be able to integrate climate risks by having them vote in favor of such proposals.
And George, from an academic and sort of empirical research perspective, maybe you could comment from your perspective, you know, who does it well and who doesn't do it well, or you know, what are their impediments to doing it well? And the common thread here, I think, is that it's a real opportunity, whatever chair perspective you are, if you can do it well, yep. You can get an edge, you can disrupt, you can really carve something out. It's a very unique time, I would submit, and George has been part of that in terms of there's data that you can make advantage of today that wasn't there. But can you talk about, there's still just dogma of efficient markets, you can't add value at all. So whether CSR would add value or detract.
Sure. I think we need to recognize at the same time that this is very difficult for many companies, actually. And there are issues where, in many cases, the economics don't work. So when you ask me about leaders, the companies that I see as leaders, and it's the same thing as the investment space as well, I think they are the ones that are realizing that in order to actually move the needle in many of those topics, you need actually collaboration at the industry level. So when you think about, for example, some of the drug pricing issues or sales practices, when it comes to pharmaceutical firms or to banks, since we're in the Wells Fargo room, right? I think there is a lot of value, actually, that we could create inside an industry and as a result as a society, if all together, for example, the big banks would come and say, let's actually increase transparency about sales practices, how we actually compensate people. And I think there is tremendous potential for this to be done, because when you look at the ownership structures, they're very common. They're the same funds that own Wells Fargo and Bank of America and Citigroup. So we have our idea that it's a textbook idea, actually, that there is tremendous competition between these firms. And there is competition between these firms, but actually there is tremendous amount of common ownership between these firms. So the free rider problem that exists if I do something as Novo Nordisk and GlaxoSmithKline or Pfizer doesn't do it, and as a result I will bear the costs, it is at the company level, but not at the investor and the owner level so much. And I think there is tremendous potential to actually increase the resilience of consumer good companies, for example, when you think about palm oil, of pharmaceutical companies when you think about drug pricing issues, or for banks when you think about sales practices and so many of the other issues that we're facing, just by recognizing that it's in the common benefit of everybody to start collaborating on some of those things, fundamentally increasing transparency, and then allowing for the market to change some of those practices. I think there is tremendous potential there. And again, when you look at the ownership structures and you take just three big passive houses, like your former employee, right, like BlackRock, and then Vanguard and State Street, all together about 10 trillion. And you look at, like, let's say the pharmaceutical sector or any other sector, they would have about 10 to 15%. So CalPERS has 0.5%. They will have 10 to 15% of the stock. And then when you look at engagement and who's voting, you actually find a tremendous force for change because most of them are passive. They will own those things. And you have every incentive, actually, to make not an individual firm, but the whole industry a better industry. So I think there is tremendous potential. And then when you look at companies like Unilever and what they are doing, actually, they are recognizing that there is a potential for collaboration at the industry level in order to make progress with some of the very big problems that we're facing right now.
That brings to mind the whole universal owner concept, which is to say you own the market, and that's, I think, CalPERS, as you've described it, Divya, has that view, and passive funds broadly. They're in the cover of the Wall Street Journal a day ago about the passive guys have come to town, and so that is an example, I think, of sort of out of the box. It's not the classic finance paradigm of a differentiated factor, but rather that, you know, there's value in governance, and we're going to have a panel. Everybody's invited to in this room at 2:30 to talk about the role of governance. It's not just an ESG issue or just a sustainability issue. It's a nuts and bolts issue that, again, go back to 1950, old school. Governance always mattered, but it doesn't easily fall in an MPT, CAPM type of paradigm. But it absolutely matters if you have governance that's aligned, that drives value, and if you have universal owners who drive for transparency to drive good business practices that will result in fundamental business results that drives value. I would almost invert it rather than an assertion of like it's a negative thing. How can that not be a good thing?
May I pick up on one thing you said there, Dan? Because you said this is not just a sustainability issue, and I think that's precisely what we are talking about here. Is that, you know, when you talk about ESG factors, then that is, in my view, only part of the performance that you should look at from a company side. So ESG has become kind of the synonym for everything that is not the financial. And I think that, you know, in our perspective, we're actually trying to argue for a much more holistic approach. So we mentioned SASB. I think we'd love to have an ASB, which is an accounting standards board, rather than a FASB and a SASB, you know. So, and I think that's something that we're struggling with, because that means that some people would say, well, but then sustainability is everything. And then you're back to what George was saying, you know, do a few things and do them well. But what we've done is actually to redefine how we think about sustainability in the company. So we have defined a framing for how we will be a sustainable business, meaning how we want to keep going, whether or not the share price is continuing to go north, then we want to be there for the patients we serve. We want to be there for the communities we are in. And in order to do so, we have to factor in these things. And I think if you can just redefine that definition of sustainability, then you will have different conversations also internally.
So maybe we can get some questions from the audience to continue the conversation. While I'll throw that out there, but then keep the questions going up here with the idea of data and metrics. So, you know, there are one of the challenges and emerging challenges and opportunities in the idea of sustainability and ESG is that there are metrics where there didn't used to be metrics. So to Suzanne's point, there's the accounting for business behavior, accounting for business value drivers that can be, you know, live served with medicine, for example. That doesn't show up on the as a revenue item so much, but it's an estimate. It's a KPI. It's a key performance indicator that's totally relevant. So what about metrics around things like a diverse workplace, social inclusion, things like climate, human rights, human capital management, supply chain risk? The list goes on. Do people have some Sure. thoughts about how to put metrics around that?
Sure. So it's sort of an emerging theme about focusing on a set of issues in order to have a impact, I think, on this panel, but we went through this process over the last year, actually, to, as you can imagine, we get bombarded by every possible issue to take a position or engage companies on, and then there are 10,000 companies that we're invested in. And so we went through a very deep dive with our board to say, what are the issues that we want to focus on over the next 5 years? And the number one thing that rose to the top, which is sort of takes account of everything, is data and corporate reporting standards. And so just one example of where we are in this space is on climate. For those who are, you know, conversant in climate change and climate risk, you'll know that there are physical impacts, there are regulatory impacts, there are different types of liabilities and transition risks. And so we just took one element of all of those things, which is the carbon footprint of companies that we invest in, and did a carbon footprint for one of our asset classes, public equity, and found that about 30% of the companies, so, you know, roughly 3,000 companies, are actually reporting their carbon footprint. Again, this is only one element of, you know, integrating climate risk. That represented about 70% of the value of the fund. And so if we want to integrate carbon into our decision making, there's still about 7,000 companies for which you either have to estimate, proxy in some way, or, and it also leaves you with the question, if they're not even doing sort of step one of reporting their carbon footprint, which is something that most companies have been asked to do for about 15 years, how are they really thinking deeply about climate in their business model and their CapEx decisions and capital allocation plans? So data and corporate reporting, is integrated reporting specifically, is sort of number one on this list. We do see a lot of already, despite not having 10,000 companies reporting in exactly the right way, I should say, we do see a lot of interesting research. We did a review of about 900 papers 3 years ago and just refreshed it to look at the link between financial performance and ESG performance. And already there's enough data that supports the integration of ESG. So we're sort of in this place where we see the signals and we see a lot of evidence that there are benefits for integrating ESG, but it's still a challenge for an institutional owner with 10,000 companies to really do it across the board in as holistic a way as we would want.
So does everybody know, you go to Google Finance, you get the CDP score?
Yep.
Like, we have a question.
Thank you all for spending this afternoon with us. I'm Adrian Rodriguez. I'm one of the future HSRIF principals. One thing that I've noticed is a lot of companies are using political activism to try to align the future state in a way that works for their business. So when I think about Uber working with regulations and asking their most loyal users to act politically, when I think about Patagonia, do you feel that you're finding businesses finding a model behind this and incorporating political activism into their business models? And how do you think about the relationship of SRI in the private sector and also the kind of the public sector?
Well, I can have a first go at that. Actually, it's an interesting question because I was recently at an event where the question was asked in the reverse way, namely that how can we as civil society, as NGO representatives, be assured that companies are not using their financial influence to influence decisions in another way? But I think it's an interesting perspective. So we've done it on a number of occasions where we've teamed up with patient organizations to really raise the level of awareness and understanding about the need for diabetes treatment in the first place. So that's a way of doing that. But I would also say that we are actually quite cautious about that because we see that we are a company, we are a commercial organization, and we do not have that, you know, democratic foundation that policymakers would have. So we do it with caution where we see that there's a space that needs to be taken up. We tend to do it with formalized institutional actors such as UN agencies or others that have a credibility that is consistent. And then we actually have some very clear, when we go into partnership, we have some very clear principles about how we do that, just to be also able to be held accountable for it.
Other comments or thoughts on the role of political activism?
No, I think parallel to what Susanne was saying, sort of corporate expenditure on political lobbying is often a risk factor. But in the lead up to Paris, under the umbrella of the UN agencies, one of the messages that we were trying to deliver to the negotiators was that the investor community is behind a strong deal, and the corporate community is also behind a strong deal. So sort of not really working, well, sometimes working together at the same event, but really more delivering that message that far from being something that detracts from financial performance, this is actually something that is good for the investor and corporate community. So there are certain issues with that that are, you know, cross-cutting that we try to have a shared message.
Yeah, just a quick one on that. I mean, we were very active leading up to Copenhagen, and we believed until the very last moment that we were able to see an agreement in Copenhagen. Obviously, that did not happen. But what I heard from some of the negotiators was actually that it was very influential that we had companies and investors mm-hmm. together doing these kinds of coalitions, because it's a very clear signal to the policymakers. So, right. Yes.
I would make a comment. The notion of Citizens United several years back decision. You know, there was a reaction that ruling would unleash floodgates of lobbying, unchecked lobbying, and risk of corrupt corporate influence on laws. There is a really, I think, healthy counterbalance to that argument, which is that the market will rule on corporate integrity and corporate behavior. And so you have, there is a role for regulation and there's a role for public policy, but I think also a really powerful role for the markets to work. And transparency, disclosure can allow the markets to work. And transparency goes a long, long way to drive accountability. Think of a few examples in the headlines. Again, the namesake room, you know, Wells Fargo, the financial impact of the issues they had with customer, you know, how they handled and didn't handle opening of accounts. The financial impact was relatively minor in terms of the direct losses to customers, $2.2 million. At the retail level, the fines levied, the initial batch of fines, 180 million or odd, relatively immaterial. The reputational damage, immense and ongoing, and it's a major, major overhang. And that's not the result of any law or judgment per se, but the verdict of public opinion and the breach of trust and the social license to operate concept is so powerful and really, I think, something to embrace. As an investor, when you're assessing, you know, is this a management team you want to back or a management team you want to get behind? Another example is Valiant, where the biggest issue there are a number of issues that toppled a high-flying stock, but core to them was a breach of public trust and aggressiveness that crossed a line in terms of a role of public integrity. And that's totally, I think, apart, incremental, separate from regulation and the heavy hand of enforced. The market does a great job if there's transparency. Disclosure goes a long way to I think, drive positive practices, which can create, a positive affinity. Customers want to do businesses with well-regarded businesses, et cetera. There's another question.
Sure. Thanks very much for coming in for your insights today. We've talked a lot about influencing companies and influencing portfolio managers, but I also wanted to ask about influencing individuals. So whether that's the public employees that CalPERS manages their pensions from, or individuals like those in the room that are investors. So how have you seen preferences for ESG change among investors, if at all? And is there a place for sort of bottom-down influence for people asking for these strategies to be used rather than a more top-down approach. Oh, sure. I'm Samantha Penabad, first-year MBA future principal for the HSRIF fund as well.
I can take that as a first step. So I think the first thing that you need to recognize in society is that people's opinions are mostly driven by what is presented in front of them. So when you are thinking about individual investors, for example, the underlying narrative and bias, even the absence of data, was that if you do ESG, you will lose money. So lots of the intermediation that was going on, when you look at like advisors and so forth, was that this is a nice thing to do, but don't do too much, because it's kind of a philanthropy thing. That was discussed, presented as a thesis and as the truth for such a long time that it's very difficult to change people's minds, even when you show them the data. And actually, even if you say, I'm actually not discussing about negative screening, not investing in tobacco, but what I'm discussing here is how do you understand employee engagement in Novo Nordisk and how does this drive the business performance in the future? Or I'm discussing about whether PepsiCo should move from a portfolio of products that are like fun for you to good for you because you're changing nutritional aspects and so forth. People say, but I excluded tobacco companies, it didn't work. I'm like, that's not what I'm talking about. So that is a long way of saying that changing perceptions that are deeply ingrained in the minds of people takes a lot of time. And personally, I have found that the best tool to do that is a relentless focus on data and rigorous analysis. And that is, in my opinion, actually the only way. It's probably a slow way, but it's the only way that systematically. But then you need to actually identify what are the levers of change in society and who actually can influence large amounts of people. In my theory of change, it's actually large institutions that operate either in the corporate sector or in the investment sector. Because actually our society fundamentally, if I could show you slides here, what you see is an increasing concentration of economic activity and power in very few actors within stock exchanges, within companies, within investment organizations and so forth that control most of the flow of both information and capital. Unfortunately, most of the people, even though they want to align their values with their value, they have been preached that by doing so, they will end up being bankrupt, which is actually not true.
So I agree with that, but I would also add to it, before coming to CalPERS, I worked for a company called Trucost, which provided environmental data and consulting to a number of different financial institutions. And one of the things we saw was a huge growth in revenues in North America over the last 3 years, primarily driven by a wealth transfer to millennials who are asking those questions. And so a lot of the funds that we were working with, which were started out oftentimes, you know, in the late 80s, built around conversations about apartheid and divestment from South Africa, and then moved into this ESG integration space, they were seeing their assets growing steadily quarter over quarter because of that sort of generational interest in ESG integration. So I agree, it has been very tough to, and I think you're held to a much higher standard than other types of analysis even, to prove the veracity and the value of ESG integration. But I'm still optimistic because I am seeing, I used to ask all of my clients, you know, what has changed, and they were seeing their assets increasing quite significantly in the wealth management space.
Can I add one more thing, which is from research, so it's cool. We did this cool study a couple of years ago with my co-author, Ioannis Ioannou, who is at London Business School. He's a great guy, smarter than me, so he would explain it better than I do. But we found that really interesting pattern It goes back to perceptions and how perceptions diverge from reality. We looked at actually what is the relationship over time between investment recommendations, Wall Street analysts that they make, and the underlying firm's ESG rating, how well they are performing on this. And we're able to show that actually what happens, especially in the early 90s and over time, they were actually, all else equal, they were more pessimistic about those companies. So they were thinking about those companies as being like kind of like fluffy, waste of resources, not very shareholder-centric and this kind of stuff. And we looked at actually whether this is related to the fundamentals. So we didn't find any relation between the ESG ratings and forecast errors or future stock performance and everything like that. But that was like pure bias. Mm-hmm. And then we were able to show that actually over time, as stock indices emerged, lots of funds were discussing about this. Companies like Novo Nordisk were able to show the value, integrated reporting, and then we showed how this bias actually got eliminated and converged towards zero. So we were able actually to model bias over time. That's what's happening out there.
Yeah, I'd add a comment. So the question again was like, what's the role of sort of retail? And I think it's immense. I think the tail's wagging the dog, in the sense that there is a real demand for just the basic notion of values alignment. The interest in ESG has really exploded on the retail kind of side of things. But there is, to George's point, just this sclerotic like negative bias because all the higher ups making the calls in the classic institutional framework grew up with an MPT CAPM framework, which didn't think quality mattered until the quality minus junk paper was published by Cliff Asness, I think in 2013, like a couple years ago. So give it, you know, they say like advance in science is made one generation at a time as everybody dies off. So, you know, there's an element of that, I think, informing the classic, you know, institutional investor kind of framework. And there's also a CYA framework of investment committees are very loath to stick their neck out, and so they ask what the consultants say, and the consultants again they crack their book on MPT and they say it's markets are efficient. You if you want to make a few factor bets, fine, but you know it's only size and value that matter. And oh, this new paper came out, quality matters, but they don't define quality using ESG. So the long story short is there's this interest, and skeptics translate it as it's a fad, it's a fashion statement. It's like, what? Remember the sneakers that had wheels that popped out of the bottom? Heelys. I don't think ESG is Heelys. It's new language around high-quality fundamental investing, which Benjamin Graham talked about in Securities Analysis in 1934. I mean, there's whole chapters in there about governance, high-quality alignment. It's basic bread, nuts and bolts. But the measurement tools are new, and so this is... a huge opportunity for those investment professionals and academics and corporate practitioners who take an informed fundamental view on it, looking for the substance of how can this add value. There is some fluff around it, and you got to cut through the fluff and focus on what's material and what matters. But there's absolutely a big interest and you look at a Google word count of sustainability or something. And you know, sustainability is the new black, right? It's there's real interest in it, but it connects to real substance that over time is going to be validated. Is it a factor that Gartz arbitraged away? Would be like, you know, one possibility, which is essentially is just saying like, well, the companies with those good business practices are underpriced today, and that'll be less underpriced in the future. But I would cite, you know, someone like Jeremy Grantham, who's has a great line. He says, look, high quality, great blue chip businesses, and it's not his words, but I would say that invoke positive ESG frameworks and invest for the long term. Just in general, they don't get overvalued. 1974, year 2000, you know, every 20, 30 years, but in general, there's evidence, and again, the quality factor and the ESG toolkit of defining those factors more specifically will be a way to frame it. But the basic notion is that there's skepticism, and that creates an opportunity for investors. So another question.
Well, my question was also on retail investors, and so we've covered a lot of what I was asking. So maybe to pivot, just to look at the role of distribution, I believe, George, you were or are affiliated with Calvert Investments, big announcement with Eaton Vance purchasing them. So same thing, you know, investors, retail investors, you know, there are the millennials and the women are saying that they want these investments. Is it just a matter of time for generational change, or is there work that can be done with distribution as far as building out the SRI, you know, investment side, the same way that the traditional financial services industry is built out? And my name is Megan Morris. I work for Hip Investor that does these ESG ratings on stocks and investments. And I got my MBA from a different school, but one that focused in sustainability.
Sure. I think it's an excellent question because I would separate two things. One is, yes, distribution matters. I think Dan can say something about that as well, having worked in just big management houses and how they are actually able to accumulate assets, because actually distribution matters. And being able to have a global footprint in a global world and have a sales force that actually educates people. And by the way, educating that sales force so they can educate people, that is extremely important as well, right? So yes, the short answer is that distribution matters. Still, we are living in a world where most of the people have investment advisors and financial advisors. That's where most of the money is. And in order to be able to tap into retail investors and educate them, you need to have an educated sales force that is traditionally affiliated with some kind of like minimum capacity in assets under management in order to be able to sustain the costs and compete. Because another thing that is going on in the industry is tremendous pressure on the fees, right? So what you're finding across the board is that everybody's trying to lower fees, and I think there are very good reasons for that. I think all of them were overpriced products, so the fees need to come down. But as the fees come down, you need the scale in order to be able to have that distribution. So you see there is a chicken and an egg problem. Mm-hmm. The other part that I want to mention is this idea of disruption in terms of distribution as well, and the whole idea about fintech as a big mega trend that is going to happen. Because I think moving forward the next 10, 20 years, what you will find is very low cost investment advisory services that are going to be basically algorithm and products that are being made in a very easy way just by reflecting the what an individual investor wants. So you go there on your app or whatever that is, and you say, I want to invest in kind of like, I want to tilt towards larger firms, higher market book, higher ESG score firms, and they construct portfolios for you. I think that's the other piece that is going on, but in my mind at least, we still need to educate people that are both in the intermediation space, at the distribution space, and the retail investors about what are we talking about to begin with. Are we talking about negative screening, positive screening, advocacy, best in class, ESG integration? What are we talking about? In order then for people to be able to make meaningful investment decisions.
I would add to George's comment that, and I think the question is a good one with regard to retail investors and what's, you know, the value of intermediaries and the power of distribution. I guess I would add that is I think equally germane for institutional investors and it's consultants rather than financial advisors. It's the, you know, top echelon pension consulting organizations really are playing that analogous role to what a retail financial advisors might pay for a mom and pop, which is and so there's been a lot of scrutiny, Department of Labor creating pressures on, is there value add for that's, I would make the comment that's deserved, I think, scrutiny for any financial services product or capability, not unique at all to sustainability or ESG, but just in any investment discipline. But But in any event, there is a role for advice and understanding what it is you want and what you're looking to do. And there is, I think, a very valid, there's a big role for education in the whole idea of sustainability, ESG integration, engaged ownership, stewardship, mission alignment. There's a whole host of issues that you can consider. We talked about the universal owner concept, the role of passive. Well, there's many different ways to do that. Do you want to do it with, one of the most imprimatur passive firms? I think $400 billion AUM. They reduce their fees to razor-thin margins by securities lending. So they lend out all their shares, which means they don't have any vote. They deliberately make the decision that to minimize fees, to maximize the pure financial returns, they're not going to vote your proxy. That's an explicit decision and a trade-off. And there are other ways that you can do passive management but retain your vote. There are there's an awful lot of complexity, and there is not, I think, a one-size-fits-all approach. That's not unique to sustainability or ESG, but I think the idea of ESG and sustainability, I think, is really healthy. It turns the whole framework of investing from an old line of trading sardines versus eating sardines, and are these just pieces of paper you're trading, or are they financial pieces of the real economy? Next question.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming and speaking at Haas today. I mean, I'm a Max Kushner-Lenhoff, a fellow at the Center for Responsible Business and a first-year MBA, and it's such an honor to have such distinguished speakers coming and taking the time to share their thoughts with us. My question is a bit of a 30,000-view question on two key issues. I previously worked in the office of the CEO at the Dow Chemical Company, and two of the big things I saw looking at sustainability were issues with authenticity and second, with accountability. And I feel like they've been touched on in this panel, but I wanted to ask explicitly questions touching on either of those. The first is on authenticity. I know that Professor Serafeim, in your book, or in your famous paper, you mentioned a bit about how it had to be material sustainability or ESG efforts for them to have an impact on business. So I was curious if there's a smell test. Is there something you can share with us, a key takeaway that would be something you could look for? And I mean, this is for the other panelists as well. As you're looking at these companies, what makes an authentic sustainability effort? And then the second one is accountability. Once you have that authentic sustainability effort, what key performance indicators need to be in place for management, and what do investors look at specifically to make sure that those goals are being delivered on?
Mm-hmm. Right. So I have a very simple test, actually, when it comes to authentic. So my test is, because I went through this kind of like case writing journey, where I wrote about 20, 25 different cases on business organizations around the world, dealing with different problems, dealing with different management challenges, and so forth. And I can tell you that all companies will say, we're the most sustainable corporation in the world. I have never heard anything opposite to that. Actually, funny enough, if you go to some websites of oil and gas firms, you will actually think that they are the WWF, not that they sell oil. All of them, actually, they're fantastic organizations. So my test is, I always ask to speak to the CFO. And that's actually a very good test, because in 90% of the cases, when I actually spoke to the CFO, his response was, what are you talking about? I have no idea what you're talking about. And I said, your colleagues told me that. And he's like, I have no idea what you're talking about. And here's why actually speaking to the CFO is very important, because he's the guy that controls the capital budgeting process. And if there are no resources behind all these things, there is nothing real. Okay, so that's my test. Okay, and I think in terms of accountability, in my textbook, actually, it links to the idea of materiality, which in our context is industry-based. So what is financially material for a pharmaceutical firm is dramatically different from what is material for a utilities company or for Nike. I think that kind of lens leads you to the idea of then how can I actually track performance of a company, how a company is moving the needle, for example, in terms of patient outcomes, right? How can I understand that? Then you can develop an accounting metric, which ideally will have the key properties of relevance, reliability, and comparability. To the extent that you can actually maximize those qualitative properties of your accounting metric that is related to financial materiality, then you can build an accountable organization. An accountable organization is not one that is releasing 300 pages with 7,000 different metrics. That is called a mess, not a report, right? And actually, as an investor, I'm pretty upset when I see all those things because I have no idea what's going on, right? So those would be my test for authenticity, and that would be my framework for accountability.
So building on that, I would say, similar to talking to the CFO, is also talking to the board. And we have a board skills matrix where we're looking for independence of the board, competence related to sustainability issues. So for example, a climate competent board, as well as diversity. And so that's on the authenticity front. If the company is able and willing to make their board available for us to engage with, that's a sign that they're really taking this seriously. And then if the board members are conversant in the various issues, and a lot of that, to be honest, we have the skills matrix, but it comes from experience of talking to lots of companies. I would say on the accountability front, adding to what George has said, there's also the financial materiality to the institutional investors. Unsurprisingly, I would say that. So some reporting frameworks really focus on corporate valuation and which metrics are specifically material in that, you know, company or industry. But when you sum it all up over 10,000 companies, we're also looking at diversity, gender equality. That's financially material to every single company. Climate risk, the carbon footprint may not be, then that's just one small example, material to that specific company. But when you look at it at a societal level, again, giving the example of our real estate portfolio, it's financially material to us looking at a systemic risk. So that's the only small differentiation I would make, is there are those metrics that are that the company needs to be accountable for because they're exclusively material to that firm, but there are also ones that go that are linked to systemic risks that institutional investors are looking for that go a little bit beyond that.
So we're at time. We've just got a couple minutes. I'd like to just amplify the last question, and as if you take nothing out of this discussion, I think this last question just nailed it. Again, how do you take stock of authenticity and accountability around sustainability initiatives? And really, you can change the word sustainability to just like corporate communication and corporate stewardship, corporate leadership initiatives. I think it's an immensely insightful question that we at the HSRF have spent a lot of time looking bottom up, taking stock. You as an outside investor, you're beholden to management communicating to you. And whether it's the comment was made earlier, whether it's financial metrics or key performance indicators around sustainability markers, humans are, the culture of humans filling in those numbers are what you're beholden to as an outsider. And whether that's lives served or EPS, if there's a culture of being aggressive in communicating those numbers, or there's a culture of conservatism, we have a huge impact on how that's relayed. I think there's a huge opportunity for leadership, and there's classic business tomes, the good to great kind of concepts. There's all kinds of stuff that's been written about, you know, does culture matter? And that's, I think, irrefutably, culture does matter. The question, though, is how do you measure and what can you make of it? That is the challenge. And the flip side, that's the opportunity for an informed investor, for an informed inside the corporation. I would suggest actually huddle up with some HSRF principals after the debate. If you're interested in this issue, we had Laura Rittenhouse, author of Investing Between the Lines, who has made her life's work on this idea of candor and management authenticity and accountability. And it's not financial statements and CSR, sustainability reporting, are not two separate things. It's one and the same. It's the fabric of communication. The fact that we've got Susanne here from Novo Nordisk speaks volumes in terms of the credibility that you've got within that firm, which is what makes it real. Divya's point about board access, that's a huge signal. Not necessarily what they say per se, but just the fact that management's there versus management maybe will make the board available versus some managements prefer to keep their board in a, friend of mine once said, in an echo chamber. They don't want any access. They're afraid of the truth. I actually spoke with happened to be with a board member yesterday at one of the companies I'm invested in, large cap U.S. Dow constituent. And he made the comment that, you know, they've got a, there's a tone in that boardroom of coming clean, open the kimono, rather than, you know, just shoot the messenger syndrome of limited information. And that's very real, and you and I think you have to be able to have a point of view on that. And the way sustainability and ESG is handled can be a great marker or barometer. Is there real corporate trust, or are they going through the motions? George's work has shed a lot of light on this. And a year ago, I think we were at an event, and you talked. I think you may have on the spot coined the phrase or the term "good washing."
Yeah.
Right. So we've all heard about greenwashing, right? People who paint the banner. But good washing, just generally, is it talk or does the actions match the talk? Pepsi, a week ago, announced a whole set of sustainability initiatives. And in my estimation, it's pretty intriguing because of the specificity that they put KPIs, key performance indicators, and markers around it. So now the jury will be out in 2020, 25. Are they going to change the goalposts or are they going to execute against them? One thing that I look for is the spidey senses. Do you think they're real? But also just trying to get your judgment out of it and just look at the behavior. If they change the goalposts, that's a red flag. There's a Canadian oil sands company that I think really creates a lot of credibility because their sustainability goals are in the CEO's letter. It's not a separate report. It's an integrated message that they have these four specific sustainability criteria, KPIs. They're audited by a third party. They report on them every year. And I think they failed on one of the four metrics. They didn't change the goalposts, though. So they get you know, real credibility for authenticity, and they need that because they need a social license to operate. To the earlier question about the role of regulation, et cetera, at the end of the day, I think as an investor, as an asset owner, as a corporation, you want to earn the goodwill and good trust to deliver value. And so we thank everybody's attention and participation and the support of the CRB and the panelists for coming in today. And thank you all.